Good afternoon, and welcome to this year's Downingtown Area Ministerium's Good Friday service. Our service this afternoon is made up of a number of famous paintings depicting the scene of each station of the cross. In the Middle Ages, many did not have the luxury of traveling to Jerusalem, especially during Holy Week. The reenactment of the Stations of the Cross allowed many to become symbolic pilgrims, reenacting in a spiritual way our Lord's Passion without actually walking the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem. Today, in the midst of this coronavirus pandemic, it is our hope that you, from the security of your own homes, will take this opportunity to once again travel with Jesus as he moves towards his final appointment with that terrible cross. For our call to worship, I will be reading both parts, but I would invite you in the comfort of your own home to join in the places where it says, people and all. Let us begin. A great teacher once said, when Jesus Christ calls us, he bids us come and die. We are the people who have responded to this call. Through Christ, we want to die to the fears that keep us from loving. Through Christ, we want to die to stubbornness that keeps us from sharing our gifts. Through Christ, we want to die to seeking our own success and salvation in disregard for the good of all God's children. This is God's promise, that if we die with Christ, we will also rise with Christ. God be praised for the glorious promise of new life in Christ. Alleluia and Amen.
What wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul? What wondrous love is this, O my soul? What wondrous love is I
Station 1. Jesus prays in the garden. Jesus left and made his way to the Mount of Olives, as was his custom, and the disciples followed him. When he arrived, he said to them, "Pray that you won't temptation." He withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed. He said, "Father, if it is your will, take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not my will, but your will must be done." Then a heavenly angel appeared to him and strengthened him. He was in anguish and prayed even more earnestly. His sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. Growing up, my parents and my grandparents and my brother and I lived in the same house. It was comforting to know that when my parents weren't around, my grandparents, especially my grandmother, was there. In my grandparents' bedroom was a small oval wooden plaque with the picture of Jesus praying in the garden. I remember asking my grandmother about the picture. She told me about how Jesus was praying to God, his Father. And she said, knowing that Jesus prayed to God, she felt comforted by praying to God when things seemed overwhelming. Over the years, as I grew in my faith, I came to understand the scene from the plaque, that classic scene painted by Henrik Hoffman, which is so familiar to many of us, shows a glimpse of the reality of Jesus' agony or struggle, accept Father's will in the way of suffering. Today, we find ourselves looking to God for strength for this time of struggle in our lives. We are restricted to a limited interaction with the world around us, beyond our front doors. We hear of our neighbors who are struggling with the COVID-19 virus. Perhaps we even know of someone who has died from it. We ask that this be taken away from us, from our community, from the world, but we know it won't be at a drop of a hat. From this station, we realize that Jesus understands us when we are weak, when we are not sure of what tomorrow will be. In Jesus, we have not a God watching from a distance, as one song puts it, but one who knows our every weakness and struggle, and who is there to help us in our time of trial. Paul tells us in Romans that Christ himself intercedes for us. At this time, let us come before God, pouring out our hearts, sharing our fears and struggles, fully knowing that God hears and responds. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for my forgetfulness at the times I take you for granted. Help me to be mindful that in my sinfulness I have offended you and grievously hurt you. Have mercy and forgive my shortcomings. Amen.
Second station. Jesus is arrested. While Jesus was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, came. With him was a large crowd carrying swords and clubs. They had been sent by the chief priests and elders of the people. His betrayer had given them a sign: "Arrest the man I kiss." Just then he came to Jesus and said, "Hello, Rabbi." Then he kissed him. But Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you came to do." Then they came and grabbed Jesus and arrested him. One of those with Jesus reached for his sword, striking the high priest's slave. He cut off his ear. Then Jesus said to him, "Put the sword back into its place. All those who use the sword will die by the sword. Or do you think that I'm not able to ask my Father, and he will send to me more than 12 battle groups of angels right away? But if I did that, how would the scriptures be fulfilled that say this must happen? Then Jesus said to the crowds, have you come with swords and clubs to arrest me like a thief? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, but you didn't arrest me. But all this has happened so that what the prophet said in the scriptures might be fulfilled. Then all the disciples left Jesus and ran away. The scholar, Anthony Apaisos, describes this painting entitled The Taking of Christ by Caravaggio for us. There are seven figures in the painting. From left to right, they are John, Jesus, Judas, three soldiers, the one farthest to the right, barely visible in the rear, and a man holding a lantern to the scene. They are standing, and only the upper three quarters of their bodies are depicted. Judas has just kissed Jesus to identify him for the soldiers. The figures are arrayed before a very dark background in which the setting is obscured. The main light source is not evident in the painting, but comes from the upper left. The lesser light source is the lantern held by the man at the right, believed to be a self-portrait of Caravaggio. Also, presumably representing Saint Peter, who would at first betray Jesus by denying him, and then go on to bring the light of Christ to the world. At the far left, a man, Saint John, is fleeing. His arms are raised, his mouth is open in a gasp, his cloak is flying and being snatched back by a soldier. The flight of the terrified John contrasts with the entrance of the artist. Scholars claim that Caravaggio is making the point that even a sinner, 1,000 years after the resurrection, has a better understanding of Christ than does his friend. Regardless of all these details, one thing is clear. Jesus in this moment brings to us a new understanding about authority. Authority doesn't belong to the strongest or even the loudest human voice in the room. They may have their day, but Christ will have his. Lord Jesus, so many times have I abandoned your teachings in favor of expediency. I have left behind all that you taught so many times and have neglected my duty to love others as you have loved me. Forgive me and bless me with your strength.
The third station. The Sanhedrin tries Jesus. But Jesus was silent and didn't answer. Again, the high priest asked, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the human one sitting on the right side of the Almighty and coming on the heavenly clouds." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we need any more witnesses? You've heard his insult against God. What do you think?" They all condemned him. He deserves to die. Jesus was judged unjustly, falsely accused. He was innocent. Even Pilate had declared that he was innocent. And still, Jesus stands unfairly condemned, betrayed again. His punishment is death. We see in Jesus the pain caused by unfair judgment and a false accusation. Through these days of sheltering in place, amid the isolation and the suffering, where have I been too quick to accuse and even condemn? Have I spoken of others in ways that do not respect their human dignity? How am I judging others unfairly. Jesus' commitment to entering our lives begins its final steps. Jesus has said yes to God and placed his life in God's hands. So must we. We follow Jesus in this final surrender, knowing that the very ones who have judged him unfairly are included in those he forgives from the cross. As he is broken and given for us, know that we are forgiven as well. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, sometimes I find myself confronted by quick accusations and unfair judgments, usually my own, sometimes from people I consider to be my friends. The pain of betrayal runs deep, yet in your case, you forgave them, and you forgive us. Teach me how to be humble and forgiving, but most of all, how to love you so completely.
The fourth station, Pilate tries Jesus. Pilate went back into the palace. He summoned Jesus and asked, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this on your own, or have others spoken to you about me?" Pilate responded, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your nation and its chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus replied, "My kingdom does not originate from this world. If it did, my guards would fight so that I wouldn't have been arrested by the Jewish leaders. My kingdom isn't from here." "So you are a king," Pilate said. Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. I was born and came into the world for this reason, to testify to the truth. Whoever accepts the truth listens to my voice." As Pilate looked into the face of Jesus, how many thoughts must have went through his head? The roaring of the crowd outside, calling for him to crucify this man. The look on the face of this man, who he knew to be innocent, not worthy of so cruel a death. He probably was filled with fear, filled with worry and anxiety, filled with selfishness of what might happen to him if he makes the wrong decision. So what does he do? He washes his hands clean of Jesus. He asks that he has nothing to do with this man. And by doing so, commits our Lord to death. Where are the moments in our own life where we have committed our Lord or others to death through indifference? Where are the moments in our life where, due to fear or anxiety or worry about ourselves, we have not spoken the truth to those who we meet, to those who we encounter? Where in our life have we washed our hands of our Lord? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, sometimes when I feel I have been let down by those I care about most, I want to abandon them and go my own way. I have no right to be this way, nor to feel as I do. Teach me always to be just and compassionate if ever I am in a position when I must make a decision concerning someone else.
Fifth station, Pilate sentences Jesus. During the festival, Pilate released one prisoner to them, whomever they requested. A man named Barabbas was locked up with the rebels who had committed murder during an uprising. The crowd pushed forward and asked Pilate to release someone, as he regularly did. Pilate answered them, "Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?" He knew that the chief priests had handed him over because of jealousy. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas to them instead. Pilate replied, "Then what do you want me to do with the one you call King of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him." Pilate said to them, "Why? What wrong has he done?" They shouted even louder, "Crucify him." Pilate wanted to satisfy the crowd, so he released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus whipped, then handed him over to be crucified. Nineteenth-century Hungarian painter Mihai Mingacsi captures the mood powerfully, does he not? Realism, in painting, has its power in capturing a scene so authentically because it makes it so real for the viewer. And that is what we are, viewers of this 1881 painting from Mingacsi entitled Christ in Front of Pilate. What we cannot imagine today, still in the early portion of this 21st century, as we congregate today on our laptops and smartphones, is that the original work was and is enormous, a staggering 13.5 by almost 21 feet long. Is not the importance of Jesus' ministry so grand, and its authentic effect on us still vitally important? For here's Jesus, looking at the one who would give the sentence of death by crucifixion, yet still loving Pilate as only God could do. This is the enormity of Good Friday. And yet, little did the artist know that his image would be broadcast to the world on Good Friday 2020 through the mutual ministry of the Downingtown Area Ministerium, whose mission is serving the Downingtown Area community in the love of Christ. Immediately our eyes are drawn toward Jesus, just left of center, and Pontius Pilate, the governor of the Roman province of Judea, who is seated on the prominent dark throne on the right. Jesus has just been brought inside the overwhelming drabness of the court. Having crossed through the portico, he stands on the lavish Middle Eastern rug in front of Pilate's judgment seat. He had probably never set foot on such an extravagant textile before in his whole life. Can we not see the gravity of the scene as the tip of the soldier's spear gives the foreshadowing of our Lord's pending death? It is a barrier that cannot be overcome. And are not the artist's use of textiles ultra-symbolic? Jesus and Pilate are both in white, both to show purity. History and our own experience illumine the divine presence and goodness of the Nazarene. But nearly as prominent is that self-prescribed human notion of greatness. That is what we are to see in the character of Pilate. He appears as physically strong as a gladiator. His garments looking as rich as his persona. Moreover, we are given the final figure dressed in white toward the left-hand side of the scene with his hands high in the air. Is he perhaps Barabbas, as he's belittling Jesus, making the overly loud case for his release, and goading the religious leaders to keep up their argument to have Jesus crucified instead of himself? We can also envision the next tier of important people within the drama. Caiaphas, the high priest, seated in red. His fellow Sanhedrin, the lawyer, identified by the red sash around his waist, demanding their case be heard by the Roman Emperor Tiberius's appointee. Look at yet another man who denotes power and privilege by what he wears. The man seated at the far right with his deep blue robe. Yes, textiles and outer coverings are important. How often does what we, in terms of clothing accessories, have, or perhaps not have, covering our bodies provide an indication for what we deem important in our lives. The common folk and those who are in power are juxtaposed, and rightly so, by the artist in this image, all to make a point. It makes me think of, in our own world today, just how essential other textiles and accessories are, as we see the great need for something as basic as a face mask. And, perhaps just as importantly, just who is and who is not wearing the same during these times of a new global pandemic, the novel coronavirus, what we think of as COVID-19. Textiles are important, whether 2,000 years ago during the time of Jesus, or 140 years ago during the time of the master painter Mihai Mungachi. And the same is true for us today. What is so very striking in Christ in front of Pilate is that Jesus looks directly at his sentencer, Pontius Pilate. The latter seems to have made up his mind at this point. For, as the arguments are being made, even as the mob is becoming more unruly, Pilate is not looking at Jesus at all anymore. He is looking down at his own hands. He is getting ready to wash them, and thereby symbolically dismissing himself from the unfolding event. And yet, as the almost drab, crypt-like quality of the whole scene depicts, he cannot totally remove himself from the deed. Mungachi artfully shows that which is beautiful, that which is promising, to be just a sliver of the entire image. That small slice of blue sky on the far left-hand side of the painting. We are, I feel, eventually drawn to that view. Perhaps it represents nothing other than Joseph of Arimathea's own tomb, the future site of the resurrection. At some point, when we look into the scene long enough, we see what is truly important, that slice of hope and future assurance. We who are Christian only understand the same through faith. At times, we can imagine ourselves fitting to any number of the character roles in such paintings. In our own lives, we judge others who may not be wearing the proper outer coverings and are, I fear, either too self-righteous about our own social distancing skills, all the while being too afraid to educate others when we see them falling short. Are our own heads already turned down? It seems that just as the artist shows us, and just as the Gospels tell us again and again, Jesus is always available to save us. Good Friday is a stop along the way on the path to Easter, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Station 5, Pilate sentences Jesus, reminds us that at times, we too are guilty of poor judgments. We are to thank God that He gives us the hope and peace, the beauty and truth. In spite of the prevailing powers of the world, His love breaks through even in the darkest of times. If we cover ourselves with Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer, we are forever clothed in God's love. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, it was my sins that condemned you to the cross, and I ask you by the merits of this sorrowful journey to assist my soul in its journey toward eternity. Never permit me to separate myself from you again, and help me to grow in my love of God, the Father, and appreciate your sacrifice for me.
6th station, Jesus wears a crown. When Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here's the man." As John chapter 19 opens, we see that Jesus has been scourged, dressed in a purple robe, mocked, and struck by Roman soldiers, in a cruel irony, they call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Jesus finally received the words he deserved, "Hail, King of the Jews!" For once, he wore a crown upon his head, yet it wasn't a gold crown of sovereignty, but a thorny crown of suffering. The thorns on this crown were long and sharp. There is no doubt they dug deep into the head of Jesus, the suffering King. I don't think I can really imagine the physical pain or the emotional and spiritual anguish he endured. Jesus, the true King, endured the pain and mockery of the crown of thorns as part of his humiliation for us and our salvation. Aren't we reminded of what Paul wrote in Philippians chapter 2? "Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." Because Jesus humbled himself, because he endured the humiliation of the cross, including the crown of thorns. For Jesus, the path to glory as King of Kings included the path of disgrace. Because he wore the crown of thorns, Jesus would receive the crown of universal worship. One of my favorite hymns is "Crown Him with Many Crowns." It is a celebration of the sovereignty of Christ. Hear this first verse. "Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of Him who died for thee, and hail Him as thy matchless King through all eternity." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, open my eyes when I am troubled, so I don't lose sight of the suffering of others. I have never thought about how it must have felt to be tortured as you were, beaten, scourged, and forced to wear a crown of thorns that ripped into your scalp. I could never bear the pain as you did without a cry, let alone forgive my tormentors and continue to love them. Help me, Lord, to learn your perfect love so that I may be the one with you in all that I do.
I was in the crowd the day that Jesus died. As he hung upon the cross, his mother cried. I saw the crown of thorns he wore, the stripes upon his back. The water and the blood ran out, and then the sky turned black. My mind was filled with anger, my heart was filled with shame. This man brought only healing, who could bring him pain? Why does it seem the strong always victimize the weak? And suddenly I found myself standing to my feet. And I cried, who nailed him there? This child of peace and mercy. Who nailed him there? Come and face me like a man. Who nailed him there? And the crowd began to mock me. I cried, oh my God, I just don't understand. Then I turned and saw the hammer in my hand. I'm just a Roman soldier, an ordinary man. I love my wife and children, I do the best I can. How could I have killed him? It must be someone else. There's got to be an answer. I just can't blame myself. Who nailed him there? This child of peace and mercy. Who nailed him there? Come and face me like a man. And the crowd began to mock me. I cried, oh my God, I just don't understand. Then I turned and saw the hammer in my hand. I nailed him there, this child of peace and mercy. I nailed him there, I am the guilty man. I nailed him there with my sins and my transgressions. I cried, oh my God, now I understand. When I turned and saw the hammer in my hand. Surely this man was the Son of God.
The seventh station. Jesus carries his cross. Carrying his cross by himself, he went out to a place called Skull Place, in Aramaic, Golgotha. That's where they crucified him, and two others with him, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. We all have our crosses to carry, those hidden battles we fight when we think no one is looking. Today our crosses are even more heavy feeling with where we find ourselves at this time with the virus. Being more isolated, we easily get caught up in what I call the Isaiah syndrome, the woe is me. We seem to be focused more on our own battles, our own problems, our own cross, that we forget to look at those around. Let us help one another shoulder our burdens together. Think of our sisters and brothers who have lost their jobs at this time, those who are out on the front lines working in the medical teams, the delivery people, the store clerks, and those who are without homes, just to name a few. How can we help them shoulder their burdens as we work with and for those whose crosses are the heaviest, the sick, the jobless, the hungry, the thirsty, the ill? Perhaps even we will truly see the face of Christ among those who suffer, and we will discover something new about ourselves and what it means to be rich and poor, and what it means to pick up our crosses and follow in the way of Christ. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, I accept all the tribulations I will have to endure for the rest of my life. I ask you, by the merits of the pain that you endured, to grant me strength to endure and carry my cross through life with patience and resignation. I repent of my sins and ask that you will help me keep from separating myself from you ever.
Eighth station, Simon carries the cross. As they led Jesus away, they grabbed Simon, a man from Cyrene, who was coming in from the countryside. They put the cross on his back and made him carry it behind Jesus. Jesus previously told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will save it. What does it profit them if they gain the whole world, but lose or forfeit themselves?" The Cyrene has been compelled by the Roman authorities to take up Jesus' cross when Jesus himself can no longer carry it. It is hard not to imagine this scene and remember Jesus' words to his disciples. Jesus is not in the business of compulsion. He will not force us to be his disciples, as the authorities forced Simon the Cyrene. Instead, Jesus invites us. Will we this day choose to be among those who carry others' burdens, or will we be counted among those who lay a burden upon others? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, I accept the cross I have to bear. You died out of love for me. Grant me strength to live for you, and if I die, let me die for love of you. Help me with your grace, that I may be aware of your will for me always.
The ninth station. Jesus speaks to the women. A huge crowd of people followed Jesus, including women, who were mourning and wailing for him. Jesus turned to the women and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, don't cry for me. Rather, cry for yourselves and your children. The time will come when they will say, 'Happy are those who are unable to become pregnant, the wombs that never gave birth, and the breasts that never nursed a child.' Then they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' If they do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry?" The women of Jerusalem are grieving. They are mourning Jesus. They had seen his compassion and welcomed his words of healing and freedom. He had broken all kinds of social and religious conventions to connect with them. Now they are alongside him here to let him know that they will miss him. Jesus feels their grief and senses their suffering. He tells them not to cry for him, but cry for the injustices that need changed in this world. He is assuring them that God's vision is one in which even they would be included, and those like them as well. All who are barren and without will be full and have enough. But they would have to act quickly. Hearts and minds would need to change. We must act quickly too. Injustice is all around us, causing much pain and suffering. Am I aware? Are my attitudes and actions in line with Jesus? Are my heart and mine aligned with his teaching? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, there is much to weep for and grieve in these dark days. We are mourning much loss right now, but I find myself grieving the loss of things that don't bring me any closer to you. Forgive me, Lord. Strengthen my resolve and set my heart and mind on that which matters most.
The 10th station, Jesus is crucified. When they arrived at the place called the Skull, they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." They drew lots as a way of dividing up his clothing. If you or I were sentenced for a crime we didn't commit, how easily and understandably could we be mad at those who accused us? How easily and understandably could we feel self-pity for what we are going through? And yet, our Lord, who is like us in all things but sin, who dies on the cross for the sake of our sin, does not feel self-pity or anger. Rather, he says, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." Today, let us think of all the times that we have sinned, that we, through our actions or inactions, have led to this moment of Jesus being crucified. And let us thank him for the gift that is him dying on the cross for our sake and for our salvation. Lord Jesus, forgive me for my forgetfulness and the times I take you for granted. Help me to be mindful that in my sinfulness, I have offended you and grievously hurt you. Have mercy and forgive my shortcomings.
Bye.
11th Station, Criminals Speak to Jesus. One of the criminals hanging next to Jesus insulted him, "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." Responding, the other criminal spoke harshly to him, "Don't you fear God, seeing that you've also been sentenced to die? We are rightly condemned, for we are receiving the appropriate sentence for what we did. But this man has done nothing wrong." It is nearly impossible for me to think clearly, consistently, and compassionately about hardened criminals who are on death row. Their station within society is so very different than my own. Now, I'm not talking about a romanticized vision of prisoners, such as when I think about those innocent, believing men imprisoned inside Nazi Germany during World War II, when Dietrich Bonhoeffer ministered to them. Nor am I thinking about the men or women unjustly tried and convicted within our own country today that we hear of in the news from time to time. I am referring to very evil men and women who have committed despicable acts and are therefore paying the price due to a society's laws and justice. Once in my early priestly ministry, I had the opportunity to visit the inside of a regional county prison when I was a curate serving at another Episcopal church. It was as surreal for me as the global pandemic is for so many of us today. I did what was told of me by those who had authority and power over myself. I had that feeling that I would get through it, meaning this half-day tour of a prison walkthrough, but I could clearly recognize I was not in control. It made me wonder about so many who were behind bars, not able to get out. Perhaps that should make us think of today what it must be like for so many of our senior citizens and those who are home alone, self-quarantining, not able to get out of their own homes. Though far from being evil, I would never say that. They too are experiencing that which is completely unnatural. In the midst of that time that I had on the prison tour, I was not thinking about the inmates having theological discussions with one another, nor was I contemplating the appropriateness of why and how they ended up where they were. I was just hoping to get through that space myself. Wherever criminals are is a very scary place for many of us. However, deciding upon who and why undeniably bad people who've committed offenses, that is a discourse that constantly needs input, evaluation, and additional work. This assertion is one that I can only make now, having had the experience of that unique county prison tour. Wherever criminals are is a chaotic place where rights and privileges are not what most of us would expect. And thus the creator of this scene before us now, for this 11th station of the cross, Criminals Speak to Jesus, the creator is unknown to me. Perhaps you know of the artist. His or her effort looks more like a war scene than that of a deep, personal, theological discussion. When we think about upon whom it is that's to receive the gift of salvation and who is not, it gets very messy for us. Maybe that's the artist's point. When we realize, I believe, that we're not in control of everything, but that the Holy Trinity is, that is exactly where God wants us to be. As my United Church of Christ sisters and brothers would often say, during our formative time together in seminary, their slogan was, "God is still speaking." The repentant thief, upon getting his spiritual act together once again on his cross, experiences the fear of the Lord. Instantaneously, God's love pours out in that Jesus invites him into paradise. all of us who believe, regardless of our own station, can always appeal to our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, so many times I've been so selfish in my pain that I forgot how others, too, feel pain. Sometimes I've forgotten to help out when I could have, and I violated your final commandment that we love one another.
Twelfth Station. Jesus speaks to Mary and John. Jesus' mother stood near the cross. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home. All of the Gospels mention women present at the crucifixion of Jesus. Matthew and Mark name a few of them. Luke mentions women, collectively, without specifics, but only the Gospel of John lists Mary, the mother of Jesus, as present at the foot of the cross. Also, John is the only to record Jesus' words to his mother Mary as he addresses her, "Woman." Mary stands at the cross, overcome with heart-torn grief. Understand that when Jesus was crucified on a cross, the cross was not high in the air, but lower to the ground, and those huddled around would have been close to the body, hanging in pain on the cross. Her son, hanging there, is finishing up all he was called to do and be, the Savior of the world. John 3:16 says this, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." And equally important is the verse that follows in 17. "For I, God, did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Yes, for God so loved the world, but that also means, for God so loved you and I. And here, as Jesus is dying on the cross, he is remembering not just you and I, but his mother as well. And so he tells his beloved disciple John, "She is your mother now. You are her son." I have comforted mothers who have seen the death of their children from violence. They wear an excruciatingly blank look of sorrow and disorientation. Their eyes grow dim and damp. They move slowly, laboring to adjust to a horrific new reality. Not only does the heart of a mother split open when their son or daughter dies in this way, but time itself breaks in two, reordered into the time before his death and the time after. Empty eyes. There are mothers we know of today that have experienced the death of sons due to violence and injustice, and now they negotiate life without them, participate in the rough rituals of mourning under the incredible burden of the violence and injustice that brought them to this place. While there may be a dignity that comes with losing sons as soldiers, and there's a sympathy that comes to mothers who lose them to illness or a tragic accident, but for mothers whose sons died from injustice and violence, these mothers have none of that relief. These women, like Mary, are thrust into spotlights tasked with asking for prayers and patience and peace in the street when their own peace won't come. And other mothers who watch these wounded women go through this pull their own young men closer, fearful of a similar fate. Let us pray. My Lord Jesus, by the sorrow you experienced in this great meeting, grant me the grace of a devoted love of your mother and your beloved apostles. Let their example of devotion become my own. Let their goodness in life become real in me. And forgive me when I turn away from you, and grant me strength to return to you humbly. Amen.
13th station. Jesus dies on the cross. After this, knowing that everything was already completed, in order to fulfill the scripture, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was nearby, so the soldiers soaked a sponge in it, placed it on a hyssop branch, and held it up to his lips. When he had received the sour wine, Jesus said, "It is completed." Bowing his head, he gave up his life. It was the preparation day, and the Jewish leaders didn't want the bodies to remain on the cross on the Sabbath, especially since that Sabbath was an important day. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of those crucified broken and the bodies taken down. Therefore, the soldiers came and broke the legs of the two men who were crucified with Jesus. When they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead, so they didn't break his legs. However, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. 14th station. Among Christians, we often fall into one of two categories. There are those of us who favor the crucifixion of Christ, and there are those of us who favor his resurrection. But it's not really an either-or proposition. Rather, it is a both-and. For our critics who would mock us singing "Pie in the Sky, By and By," and saying that is all we have to offer, I say, look at the cross. Our Savior, Jesus the Christ, came to earth and suffered our death to demonstrate that we have a God who knows our pain, has taken on that pain, and walks beside us in our daily pain and our daily struggles. The gospel we proclaim is deeply rooted in the reality of the cross, the reality of our world. You can't get to the resurrection without going through the crucifixion. When Jesus tells us as his disciples we need to daily take up our cross, Jesus is inviting us to recognize that even the painful realities of our own lives are but momentary, and that God indeed does intend for everything to be worked towards good, even the present moment we find ourselves in. 15th station. Let us pray. My dying Lord Jesus, I embrace devoutly as I behold the cross you died on for me. My sins have merited for me a miserable death, but by your death, I have hope. Let me die embracing your feet and burning with a love for you.
The 14th station, Jesus is laid in the tomb. After this, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate if he could take away the body of Jesus. Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but a secret one because he feared the Jewish authorities. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and took the body away. Nicodemus, the one who at first had came to Jesus at night, was there too. He brought a mixture of myrrh and aloe, nearly 75 pounds in all. Following Jewish burial customs, they took Jesus' body and wrapped it, with the spices, in linen clothes. There was a garden in the place where Jesus was crucified, and in the garden was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish preparation day, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus in it. How often death looks like a final solution. How easy is it for us to see this scene and think that it is over, that it is done? And yet we know that in 3 days, on Easter Sunday morning, they will find the tomb empty and our Lord resurrected. May we, in our moments of doubt, our moments of anxiety, when we think that this is the end, turn and remember our Lord, who rose from the dead and is inviting us through trust in him to do the same. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you rose again on the third day. I ask you by your resurrection to make me rise gloriously with you at my last day. Let me be always united with you in heaven to praise you, love you, and glorify you forever. Amen.
Shall find rest beyond the river.
wait here.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. Bear a precious fountain, free to all the healing stream.
We flows from
Calvary's mountain. In the cross, in the cross,
it is
my raptured soul shall find rest beyond.